Shall we? Gautham, shall we start?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay.
Good evening. Welcome back for more session on GE Stoma. So yesterday we had a brief outline regarding what are stomas and basic introduction. Followed. Today we'll venture into a more are likely to encounter the difficult stoma as well as the issues related to the stoma care of the patient. So what are the principles of stoma creation? So it's basically the same as requirement for an anastomosis. The stoma should be created in such a way there is no tension, as well as the blood supply is preserved adequately. Similar to any anastomosis, the stoma also doesn't allow any room for error. So invariably it will show up in the post-operative setting, which can lead to another intervention and significant morbidity. It is very vital, especially in case of a difficult stoma, that the surgeon knows about the patient completely. It might be starting from the body habitus of the patient. It might be related to the number of surgeries the patient has undergone previously, the disease process that we are expecting, and also know about the social support system the patient is likely to have. So when do we typically encounter difficult stoma creation? It can be related to three things, which can be the disease related factors or the patient related factors, sometimes even the surgery related. Sometimes patient has multiple surgeries, scars all over the abdomen, sometimes deformed abdomen. So all these forming in stoma, difficulty in forming stoma. So what are the common disease related issues that we encounter? First is the shortened mesentery, that which is typically seen in processes like tuberculosis, malignancies, carcinoid tumors. Sometimes even a 5 days, 10 days old perforation pattern, you are likely to have some amount of septic reaction. It can be dilated bowel, typically when we come across a left-sided colonic malignant obstruction, we are forced to do a diversion, or in the Hartmann's procedure, we have to deal with the dilated bowel. In unfortunate situations, we might have to have an open abdomen as well as a stoma, which is actually a very difficult scenario to manage. And again, previous surgeries can compound the issues. So when we are looking into each of the factors, the first factor we'll take now is the shortened mesentery. As I said, the two most common conditions which we encounter are tuberculosis and malignancy, which tuberculosis is really dreadful. Surgery for say FAP, and now is having a desmoid in the mesentery, which is causing shortening and inability to bring the intestine to the anterior abdominal. So the resected specimen I just put forth to highlight the issues that we are likely to encounter in case of a tuberculosis. This specimen is an ileocecal tuberculosis, with there was a minute perforation. Patient actually presented with chronic obstruction and recurrent fever. And we did have the ileum which is stuck to the tuberculoma, ileocecal tuberculosis. Adjoint, this inflammatory process is also likely to be involved, thereby shortening the mesentery. This patient, in all likelihood, also has a strictures lesion involving the ileum. We can see the discrepancy in the ileum here as well as the ileum here. So there is some amount of obstruction also in this patient. So now we are having two problems with related to stoma. One, the mesentery that is likely to be shortened. Second, dealing with a dilated bowel due to the obstruction. So how do we overcome the shortened mesentery? This is not in any particular order. these can be jumbled either way, but generally this is what I follow. The first is score a division of the intestine, division of a vascular pedicle, and probably choosing an alternative site. So we'll see them in detail. Remember, the mesentery is actually of mesothelial cells, and in between there is fat and vascular pedicle. So most of the inflammatory pathologies that we are talking about, be it tuberculosis or perforation peritonitis, is likely to involve the mesothelial layer and not the fat. So a simple scoring of the mesothelial layer will enable us to lengthen the mesentery, thereby enabling the segment of intestine to come to the anterior abdominal wall. It is done along one axis. It is done transverse to the mesentery vascular axis. Suppose, despite the scoring, we are not able to bring out, then likely that the inflammatory process is quite significant, which will not help further mobilization. So, in those cases, instead of bringing out a loop stoma, it is sometimes easier to make a stoma after the division of intestine. So, for example, this is the end stoma This is the loop which was supposed to be brought out. Now you have a mesenteric process which is involving the inflammation. You are likely to have further issues in stoma maturation. So in those scenarios, dividing the intestine and letting go the distal limb into the intraperitoneal component, just fashioning an end ileostomy, can help us to mature a good stoma. The next step, despite division, I'm not able to bring out the intestine to the anterior abdominal. What I do is try to divide and vascular pedicle. All the intestines, they have multiple layers of arcade. So the arcade goes like from the root, there is minimal arcade, the arc of Riolan, and all those things will take care of the proximal blood supply. The next is the marginal artery, which we commonly encounter. So at dividing the major artery, say for example, in this situation, I have highlighted the ileocolic artery, despite being ligated or divided, the blood supply to the intestine is still preserved by the marginal arteries. However, by just simple division, as you can see, I am able to bring the intestine, which is almost like king to one, in an extended format. So this is a process which we also use in pouch surgery, where we remove a part of the pedicle. It is not mere division. Remember, just division may not lengthen the mesentery as much like removal of the vascular pedicle. So it is always preferable to remove the vascular pedicle from the root to the point of marginal artery to have the maximum mobilization of the intestine possible. Why did I keep the last option is probably in a loop ileostomy, which I constructed, or I had the same case, ileocecal tuberculosis with stricture perforation. I wanted to bring this part of the stoma out, this part of the intestine as stoma. Now imagine if this part of mesentery is involved, which typically occurs in ileocecal tuberculosis, if the rest of the mesentery is good, I might as well as choose another site which is devoid of any inflammatory process and which can come to the anterior abdominal wall in a tension-free manner. Why do I need to do this? An improperly constructed stoma is likely to have serious repercussions in the postoperative period. Also, I would like to just make a note here. If I want to bring this part of the intestine, which is devoid of any inflammatory process, in case, it will come to the right iliac fossa. However, suppose if I decide that this part is involved in the inflammatory process, and only thing. Okay, you would like, I would be requiring to remove this part of the vascular pedicle. So imagine this part of the intestine is unlikely to come to the right iliac fossa. It is more likely to come to the left iliac fossa or left paraumbilical region. So don't go with the fixed notion that an ileostomy has to be constructed in the right iliac fossa and only the terminal portion has to be always used as the stoma mentioned. We try it in all ideal situations, but in case we are not able to achieve it after performing all the maneuvers that we have discussed, then it is not wrong to perform it in the left iliac fossa with that proximal power. So this is what I was talking about. This is called a pseudo loop. Basically, we divided the intestine. But we were not able to bring it out because we brought out another proximal bowel as a loop. So the question can be raised. Why not resect this bowel and mature a good end ileostomy? We don't know the disease process. Suppose we are talking in terms of a Crohn's. Every centimeter of intestine that can be preserved needs to be preserved. So if this length is around 20 centimeters, why unnecessarily remove those 20 centimeters? During the reversal, I will probably restore this small intestine with the rest of the large intestine and close the stoma rather than losing this 2 centimeters just to make a good end ileostomy. This is not ideal, but still it is a good procedure in case of a difficult stoma. These are two pictures I have placed to highlight in the attachment of root of fossa. See, the one on the left indicates the green color, which is highlighted. That shows the root of the fossa. It is probably 5 centimeters to the left of midline and, in its superior portion, and 5 centimeters to the right of midline in its inferior portion. But it's almost near vertical. It is not placed transversely. And the one on the right is a sagittal section, which is taken almost in the midline. You can see the distance between the mesentery and the umbilicus is almost the shortest when compared to any region of the anterior-abdominal wall. So even if there is an inflammatory process that is involving the mesentery, the shortest distance for the mesentery to reach the anterior-abdominal wall, the bowel to reach the anterior-abdominal wall, is likely to be the midline. In case of all the options being exhausted, you are not able to achieve the ideal para or within the rectal paramedian placement. Of the stoma respect to the skin incision. So the intestine can be at the end or can be even a proximal loop that is brought out. With respect to the skin incision, it may not be only the right iliac fossa in case of an ileostomy. It can be the left or sometimes left hypochondrium in case of a proximal genital involvement or sometimes even the midline if the mesentery is involved in severe inflammatory process. So coming to the next possible scenario where we have difficult stoma formation is a dilated bowel. The obstructed intestine is already partially ischemic because of the congestion. In fact, if you mature an obstructed intestine post-resection, you will find it angry looking. It is more likely to be friable. It's an obstructed intestine. And especially in case of a dilated colon, you are talking of sometimes even a centimeter diameter of a colon, which is already stretched and it's likely to be friable. So bringing out through a large abdominal wall trephine is likely to lead to a parastomal hernia in the post-operative period. So how do we do it? Better to decompress. When we decompress, always remember the length of the intestines changes. For example, if we had an CSC sigmoid, for which we are planning an Hartmann's procedure, you will find before the decompression was made, the end of the fossa. But once the distension got relieved after decompression, you will find it not even reaching up to the umbilicus. So always be aware that the length changes once decompression occurs. Don't make the skin incision before decompression. Why I stress upon this is, once you make an 2 centimeter wide skin incision, remember, if the intestine cannot reach that part of the anterior abdominal wall, then a stoma cannot be made even somewhere adjacent to it, because then future the stoma bag application will be difficult. So always decompress before the structure adequately before making a skin incision. So once decompression made, it avoids discrepancy large opening that we talked about earlier in the abdominal wall. Open abdomen and stoma are very two difficult things to handle together. But sometimes it is inevitable, especially in emergency scenario. At least if there is no enterocutaneous fistula, there is no leak from the abdominal wall, then it's easier to manage. We can apply a Euro bag or a Babata bag to tide over the crisis, and it can be dealt similar to a midline wound with respect to the stoma. However, in case if there is a fistula, suppose we are dealing with a crunch with multiple perforations, and there is a new onset perforation proximal to the stoma, then you are in trouble. You will have to apply a wound manager, which will take some amount of space for the addition to occur. So you are talking about 5 to 6 centimeters from the wound edge, which is taken for the wound manager, and another 5 centimeters, which is required for the stoma bag to be applied, which is highly unlikely. We are unlikely to get such a vast space in the abdominal wall to have both the appliances applied properly. So in these scenarios, it's very difficult, and generally what I have seen happens is there is a leakage. The stoma is no longer anteriorly placed. Because of the retracted abdominal wall, it goes to a more lateral position. It starts leaking. Application of bags become difficult, and actually it's a terrible period. It's a difficult scenario to manage for the patient as well as for the surgeon issues. The most common issue that we encounter will be the obesity. So two places the fat creates issue for us. One is in the subcutaneous, that the stoma, the intestine has to pass through a larger distance to come to the skin surface. And also, imagine a patient who is lying down and getting up. The lower abdominal wall generally is more pendulous in obese individuals. So the thickness of abdominal wall increases whenever a stoma is created in the lower abdomen. I will highlight in this with the image later on. The second problem is with the mesentery fat. A bulky mesentery or a bulky appendiceal epiploike is likely to hinder us in bringing out the stoma as well as maturating it, stoma maturation becoming very difficult. So in these scenarios, the upper quadrants, either the right or the left, are better sites than the lower abdomen, because the subcutaneous fat in these regions are thinner, and they are anchored to the costal margin. So they are unlikely to have any variation with respect to position. Also, the distance between the vascular origin and the proposed stoma sites in the upper quadrant is the same and shorter. So these are two images again. The one on the left is from an article in Springer, which spoke about fat metabolism and distribution in the humans. We can find supraumbilical, the fat is almost probably 1.5 times the muscular thickness. But in the infraumbilical, definitely the deeper layer of fat has more is more thick, and the thickness of the fat is almost 2.5 times the muscular thickness. So this is what the thickness is lesser in the supraumbilical region. And here on the right side, the pendulous abdomen, she was lying down, the abdomen would be somewhere here. Just because the patient has started ambulating, now because of the pendulous lower fat, you will have an increase in length of 2 centimeters. So again, this makes a huge difference, because if you had struggled with the stoma and somehow you have brought it out into the lower abdomen just adequately, and then this patient starts ambulating, because of this increase in 2 centimeters, you will invariably find a mucocutaneous disruption that occurs in the 5th day or the 7th day, and then patient will have peristomal excoriation and soilage, leakage of the bag, but the stoma will not go beneath the sheath, because that is more or less safe. It is only the mucocutaneous disruption that will happen with this pentulous effect. So to avoid all these problems, it is better to have it in the upper abdomen. Again, we are expecting the origin of the vessels to be somewhere here. They are not likely to be here. This is the umbilicus. So your aorta and the superior mesentery is supposed to be somewhere here. The bifurcation occurs here. So this is a shorter distance when compared to distance here. It leads to likely lead to stretching. So this is what I was talking about. An upper abdominal stoma is better in case of an obese individual. So during the procedure, what are the things to facilitate the passage of the intestine through the abdominal wall? One easy way is to have a small wound protector, which can be applied for a 4 cm fine, and the protector ensures that the bowel is brought out without any friction with the subcutaneous or the skin. Once the intestine is brought out, then we can divide the bone protector and remove it. The other technique is to do a staged mobilization. See, if you are having a sheath thickness of 2 cm and you are having a fat thickness of 4 cm, rather than pull or push a bowel across 6 cm in a single stage, we can stage it and probably bring it out through the sheath at the first stage, then make a skin incision and bring it out through the subcutaneous fat. So this is called stage mobilization. This is very helpful when we have an extra obese individual. So we do require to create a plane here between the sheath and the subcutaneous fat, similar to how we do in open incisional hernia repairs. And once we reach the lateral aspect of the proposed stoma site, then we make a skin in the incision in the rectus, where we bring out the intestine. Once the intestine is brought out here, the flap is again repositioned to make a skin incision through which the intestine is brought out. A special mention about left colon. See, in contrast to our small bowel, the secondary retroperitoneal structure, so it is attached to the abdominal wall by means of its lateral peritoneal reflex. In case we are not able to mobilize it to the anterior abdominal, the first thing is to take down the lateral peritoneal reflection across the entire cranial caudal length, followed by which the medial peritoneal attachments to the base of the colonic mesentery can also be divided to increase its mobility. If these don't help in bringing the intestine to come to the surface, then we go ahead with the splenic flexure mobilization. And the final step is to divide the inferior mesenteric artery and the inferior mesenteric vein at its origin. So what do I mean by at its origin? In case of inferior mesenteric artery division, it has to be done probably 1 cm distal to the origin from aorta. In case of IME, it is done just inferior to the tail of pancreas. So both these divisions will increase the length of colon mobilization and thereby enable us to do a good stoma. So again, a word of caution here. This is a pictorial representation of an Hartmann's procedure. So we remove the diseased segment of sigmoid and the distal end is closed. The proximal is brought out as stoma. Imagine this stoma, once this is how the sigmoid was divided. If at the end of this step, if we start marking the skin, what generally happens is we'll mark it little lower down or in the classical left mucosa. But once it is not coming to the anterior abdominal wall, so then we start dividing the mesentery, like how we did for ileum. We can also divide the IMA and IME as we talked just earlier. Once it is divided, the colon is likely to move cranial. So if you had marked somewhere here, you will see once the mobilization is complete, the colon no longer reaches the left iliac fossa, but it is likely to come more cranial position and around umbilicus or even supraumbilical. So one more reason, again I insist, whenever you are dealing with a difficult stoma, always mobilize the intestine appropriately. Ensure it is coming at least 3 to 5 cm above the abdominal wall. That is an average marker which I keep. And then make the skin. Suppose if I had made the skin incision here, then if I make the stoma here, application of the stoma bag becomes difficult here. That's why do the adequate mobilization, then the skin incision. Yes, there is a role for non-averted ileostomy, but it is not ideal, but it can be done in emergency situation. But most important thing to keep in mind is to plan each and every step. Despite all this planning, sometimes it is not possible to mature a stoma. Like for this is a patient whom we had operated a month ago, who had malignancy related cocoon abdomen. There was, the mesentery was completely shorted. There is no way we could bring out any part of the intestine to come out. Though the patient had obstruction, the idea was to relieve, probably the site of obstruction was ileocecal region. The idea of going in was to do a loop ileostomy or end ileostomy so that the patient can take over. We couldn't achieve it. So I'm just saying there is possibility that the disease process is extensive, we may not be able to make a stoma. So coming to the postoperative period in difficult stoma, the most common complication we anticipate is stomal ischemia. It is very important to assess this ischemia because it alters the management. Ischemia can be either suprafacial or subfacial with respect to the rectus sheet, that is either superficial to the rectus sheet or deep to the rectus sheet, and it can be either mucosal or full thickness. So why should the assessment be done? In case of a mucosal ischemia, it is generally self-limiting. It results in mucosal sloughing and regeneration with no long-term sequelae. However, if the muscle is also ischemic, then it is of some concern. This is a chart which I prepared just to understand both the factors. For example, in case of an suprafacial mucosal ischemia, what we anticipate is just the mucosal sloughing with no long-term sequelae. So it is generally managed conservatively. However, a suprafacial full thickness, again, there will not be any immediate need for revision. They are likely to heal. They are likely to heal with some inflammatory process resulting in stenosis. So the patient might require a revision at a later date, not in an urgent setting. When it comes to subfacial ischemia, again, mucosal ischemia, we are not worried. We'll just plan conservative management as long as the stoma is functioning and patient is good. But we keep a monitoring serially done so that it doesn't extend transmural ischemia. However, if there is a subfacial and a full thickness ischemia, this will invariably lead to revision of stoma because the chances of intestinal gangrene followed by perforation and peritonitis is likely. So if you encounter ischemia which is having subfacial ischemia with and involving the entire thickness of the bowel, kindly proceed with revision of stoma. How do we assess? The simple test that we use bedside is called the tube test. Wherein a transparent test tube, I prefer a glass test tube because of its transparency, not the plastic one, is inserted into the stoma under a pen torch. Some people even use an ophthalmoscope because of the optics. It is used to illuminate the torch. So if there is pink mucosa, which is identified through and through, that means there is no evidence of ischemia. If it is just identified above the facial layer, then again, unlikely the inferior aspect will alone be necrosed. In case, if we find an ascemic mucosa, to ascertain whether it is mucosal or it is full thickness, then we just use a needle to prick it, the area where the ischemia is suspected. If there is bright red color blood that is emanating out of it, then likely the muscular perfusion is maintained. In case there is no blood, no bright red that is coming out of it, then we should suspect muscular. So in this scenario, if there's a subfacial as well as a full thickness ischemia that is suspected, we might have to revise the stoma immediately. So stoma care. This is something which we usually tell the patients once they get discharged. So these are some of the instructions we tell them personally. We ask them to change the bag immediately if leakage occurs in order to prevent excoriation. A single piece drainage system lasts for 1 to 3 days, and a two piece can come even up to 5 to 7 days. It is always advisable see the stoma bag when it's one third full. Never wait for half or full, because once it goes about one third, if there is a difficulty and access to a stoma, then the bag might become full and it can lead to an inadvertent leakage, an inappropriate situation. We also ask the patient to observe the color of stoma, whether it's the structure of stoma, whether it's prolapse, retracting, whether there is any bleed or stuff. We ask the patient to make a note of the consistency and the amount of effluent that is coming from the stoma. Look for any peristomal skin changes in the form of redness or excoriation. We ask them not to irrigate the bag. It's very important because majority of times they don't want to remove it with their hands. So they just put in water to irrigate the bag, which is not advisable because it is likely to seep between the adhesive layer and the skin, that way causing bag to get dislodged. That is something of it. But is it the real stoma care? I think it is often neglected that the patients are not thought about proper stoma care. For example, I know many of us who do a gastrectomy, we do tell the patient, take a small amount of food, which is frequent, avoid taking solids and liquids together. We know behind the physiological process that it might lead to dumping. But how often have we actually spoken to a patient regarding the stoma? How often have we told this is the diet that you are likely to, you should take before they ask? And this is irrespective of the preoperative counseling. Imagine in an elective setting, especially if it's done for a malignancy, the patient mindset is to get rid of malignancy. Yes, they do have an idea of stoma, but they may not be actually knowing everything about stoma, what to take, what to do, what not to do, and all those things. In an emergency scenario, it is all the more worse. The patient literally doesn't know about what is stoma and how to take care of it. So educating the patient as well as the attendant in a complete manner marks true rehabilitation in these situations. So who are the members who actually take care of stoma? It is not the stoma care nurse alone. It is a group which is formed by the surgeon and oncologist. Why I included an oncologist? Suppose we operate a patient for CA rectum who has undergone ultra low anterior resection with the loop IDS. This patient is doing fine. He is doing fine at the end of 2 weeks. He's now, based on the tumor characteristics, he now requires adjuvant therapy. The first thing he comes and asks me will be to whether the stoma can be reversed now before the chemotherapy. So I will then say no. I will say why? Because any delay in initiation of chemotherapy after the fourth week of any colorectal malignancy decreases the survival rate by 17% at 5 years. That is a significant proportion. So I will say if you are going to get it reversed and then the wound to heal again, they are going to cross this deadline of 4 weeks. So no, kindly go back, get the chemotherapy done and then come for restoration. So then again he'll come. If the 6 cycles are planned, he'll come back after 2 cycles and say, sir, now I have undergone partial chemotherapy, at least reverse it now. If you ask me personally, I will not reverse it even at that point. Why? To be comfortable with any restoration, I would require a 3-week window period from the chemotherapy to my surgery. And for the wound to heal, again, from the surgery to another 2 weeks. So you are already looking at a loss of 5 weeks or a delay by 2 weeks in giving chemotherapy. If it turns out to be an uncomplicated restoration, which no one can guarantee. So I would always tell the patient, complete your chemotherapy regimen. We'll assess at the end of 6 cycles of chemotherapy. Who knows, the patient might even develop liver metastasis. So I can do the restoration and metastasectomy at the same sitting also. So in those scenarios, I will also talk to the oncologist, telling kindly talk to the patient to emphasize on all these factors. The social worker is for the economic reasons. Patient may not be able to afford stoma bag in all scenarios. So they need to be counseled where to get, how to get, and how frequently to change. And what are the, we do have a lot of concessions for stoma patients. So they need to be aware of that. Dietitian is important to ensure that the proper diet is given to the patient. The most important person in the entire team will be the caregiver, who is going to spend probably his or her 24 hours with the patient to ensure the patient returns back to near normal life. It cannot be a normal life for stoma, to ensure the patient comes back to a near normal life. So caregiver also has to be educated appropriately. So coming to the dietitian, the typical diet that we suggest will be a low fiber diet. That is to avoid all your green leafy vegetables, to ensure the patient takes more liquids, because there is likely to be an increased loss during the early post-operative period. Based on the other comorbidities, we might have to alter the the fluid intake, the calorie intake, the electrolytes intake, and all those kind of stuff. This again varies dramatically. If I am constructing a stoma which is very proximal, like even proximal jejunostomy or even at jejunoileal junction, we are also looking at the difference in absorption of drugs that we are going to take. Okay, for example, if you are looking at aspirin, they are all absorbed in the gastric and duodenum and proximal jejunum. But azithrom is not the same nature. So if you are looking at a patient who is taking on azithrom, we might have to re-titrate the azithrom dosage before discharge. And the patient might need supplements when they are malnourished. So I always believe the surgeon is the one who is ultimately responsible for the stoma. Because he or she has been involved through the period. The surgeon has decided the need for stoma. The surgeon has created the stoma and knows what are the pros and cons of that particular stoma that was created, and also is involved in the post-operative management. It can be as small as deciding the orientation of the stoma bag. In the immediate post-operative period, when the patient is not ambulant, the bag is applied in a transverse direction so that the bag is outlet lies on the lateral side of the patient. This is because patient is not likely to get up, so the emptying of the bag can be done when the patient is lying down. But once the second day or the third day, patient is starting to ambulate and is more sitting rather than lying down, now the bag's orientation has to be changed. Orientation has to become made vertical so that the emptying can be done in a restroom, can be done in the patient's sitting position. So even during the early daily rounds, I think it is very important on our side to ensure that even as small as this orientation of stoma bag is ensured. What are the other concerns the patient is likely to have? The body image. It has a severe impact on their perception of their body. We do keep transparent bags in the first 2 or 3 days to observe if there is any issues with the stoma. But if you carefully observe, once you change from a transparent stoma bag to an opaque stoma bag, you will find the patient being more communicative, patient being more comfortable. The simple reason is he no longer steals his tools. He or she no longer sees the stoma. So that makes them little more comfortable. So try to switch on to an opaque stoma bag earlier. The patient has to be assured there is an independence in self-care. He should not believe or made to believe that he needs support from anyone else throughout the rest of his life or during the period of temporary ostomy. Important to talk to the patient regarding the society accepting as he is. Many a times I find this very difficult. They do have a self-inhibition to interact with others. The most important way I think this can be overcome is just by a group counsel. When we have a patient who's having a stoma, say post-APR, a person talks about his or her way of managing the stoma, I think that gives the maximum comfort to the patient and the attenders rather than surgeons or experts in this field talking repeatedly to the patient. Patient also has to be assured regarding the job security. Many of them believe they cannot travel. So we should tell them, yes, you can travel. There is no problem in traveling. But ensure certain things. Take adequate supply. When you are traveling in a flight, ensure that you have some in your hand luggage, some in your check-in luggage. Why? Sometimes check-in luggage can get lost, can get delayed, but you don't want to be stranded in an airport with your bag full of pieces. Cut the stoma before boarding because the scissors may not be available on board. Fasten the seat belts either above or below the stoma. Take the aisle seat rather than the window seat because it gives you an easier access to the toilet. Avoid caffeine or fizzy drinks and ensure adequate hydration. Another important aspect which we often neglect, and I do some find nowadays, patient leaving the room and then coming back again. the attendants would have left. The patient comes back to me again and asks secretly whether now can I indulge in all sexual activities. Imagine a patient who is 25 year old who has already undergone total colectomy and or probably total proctocolectomy because of a malignancy. He's married for 3 years or something. So for him, this is an important part in their rehabilitation. Don't ever neglect it. It is for us to make them and does not get hurt during any sexual intercourse. Just by simple measures like emptying the pouch prior to the act or ensuring proper addition, enabling them to share their feelings with their partner will improve their sexual health. And also just tell them that during sexual activity, generally bowels are relaxed. So it is unlikely that the stool or gas will enter the stoma during the sex. The other concerns, financial issues, it generally result out of inadequate understanding or knowledge deficiency. The patient doesn't want to clean themselves. They want a stoma therapist to come and clean. Every visit, the stoma therapist charges 500. So you are talking about every 4 days, a stoma person comes. And whenever they travel, they don't know whether they can handle. So an adequate education of the patient and their attendance is paramount to reduce this financial burden. Again, which is not in under our control, sometimes they might develop allergy to the products. There might be some kind of skin exfoliation. And any stoma-related complication is likely to increase this burden. So take home, always assess the patient. See the patient yourself, ensure you know complete history about the patient so that you have a preoperative mindset as to how difficult the stoma preparation is. Difficult stomas are encountered on a day-to-day basis, especially in a high-volume center, and we need to be aware as to how they can be managed. Post-operative assessment is paramount in these difficult stomas to ensure timely intervention rather than waiting for the patient to perforate and then having to re-explore. Surgeon has the ultimate responsibility, including the post-operative period. So any time patient comes for post-operative visit, like how we ask what they eat, how they urinate because to rule out bladder dysfunction, I think we should also ask them how they are taking care of the stoma, whether they are having any concerns regarding the stoma, and to appropriately educate them. So the stoma care is not physical alone. Thank you. There are any queries?
Brilliant lecture as ever, Gautham. And unlike lap cholecystectomy or a lap appendectomy or a hernia repair, almost 50% of a stoma will either be improperly constructed or have some sort of a complication. If there is anyone who has not seen a complication, I mean, it's very difficult to believe that. And these are so very common. And again, majority of the times, you know, the patients are unhappy. We may not be managing the problems properly. And actually, you have brought it out so nicely, so many newer aspects to it. And it's the lecture is really wonderful. Now we'll throw open to the audience and anyone who want to ask questions, please raise your hands or, you know, unmute yourself. And there's somebody who raised a hand in the beginning itself. Please come up and unmute yourself and ask a question and also put your video on, please. Anyone? Yes. Any questions?
Hello.
Yeah, Meghna.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. So my question is, what is, sir? I don't know.
Okay, no
also,
problem.
I'll try to fix it. I don't know.
Okay, no problem.
Sir, what is stomal enema and how do we give it?
Okay. Stomal enema is, I would term it as more stomal irrigation rather than stomal enema. Stomal irrigation is typically done when we have a large intestine, which is kept as colostomy and colostomy, when we are trying to ensure that the feces is completely evacuated. Many a times, even after say a day or two, when the stoma is filled, only 100 grams or 250 grams comes out. Because of some redundancy, there might be some amount of fecal still getting retained. So in those cases, it is preferable to give a stomal irrigation every third day. It can be, it's best with the saline, or it can be, sometimes tap water can also be used, but we should be aware of it. That is just to ensure that the feces doesn't get retained in the incipient.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, actually, welcome, Professor Anandi. Ma'am, would you, I mean, if you can show up and make a comment? Dr. Anandi? Yeah, any other questions? Yeah.
Sir, what is the high output stoma, and how to manage this high output stoma, sir?
I'll be dealing with this in managing the stomal complication, but typically we keep it as, for ileostomy, it is 1 liter. Anything more than that, we take it as high output. With respect to jejunostomy, it is basically constructed as a high output stoma. Definition for colostomy, but if the patient is having any increase in bowel movement or the increase in stoma output over and above normalcy, it is probably 3 times a day. Then after 8 days, the criteria is 8 days. We expect the physiological return of the stomal activity to normal by 8th day postoperative. Anything increase of more than 1 liter after this 8th day is considered as stomal diarrhea in case of ileostomy.
And how to manage this, sir?
The main thing that we'll have to take care of is fluid and electrolyte imbalance. It occurs primarily due to the decrease in adaptation that needs to occur proximally. Whenever we lose fluids or electrolytes or nutrients, the body has its own feedback for the jejunum to get adapted. This is typically how it occurs even in a short bowel syndrome. So the stomal output is likely to decrease. Once we are in case of ileostomy, in case of colostomy. In case of ileostomy, the reasons are likely due to the failure in adaptation. So our management will be more supportive. We'll try to ask the patient to take more ORS solution over and above 1 liter of the stoma output. The patient has 1.5 liters of stoma output. Up to 1 liter, there is a physiological control. The patient, the body can adapt. But more than that, even above 800 ml, you will need to give ORS solution for the amount exceeding 800 ml. Electrolytes will be taken care of by the ORS solution. If it's still persistent, then we'll have to, probably for a week, then we'll have to start thinking about other processes rather than just adaptation. So, this is more important case of colon, where we can have antibiotic-related diarrhea. They can have, because of the profound antibiotic, patient can develop secondary lactose intolerance. So in those cases, you ask the patient to avoid lactose-based diet. You ask them to avoid any hyperosmolar content, even sucrose-based diet, sometimes avoid it. Any antibiotics, if patient is broad spectrum, is stopped, we can give them bifilac. I've even seen patients with ileostomy high output respond with bifilac. I'm not sure how much it has some scientific value, but yes, it does decrease the output. If ruling out other causes of high stoma output, if the patient is just having failure, we can even give them loperamide. It's an anti-motility agent which can be given to reduce the fluid and electrolyte loss.
Thank you, sir.
So, any more questions? Any more clarification? Yeah, Meghna?
Sir, once we mature the stoma, when do we remove the sutures, the skin sutures?
Okay. Generally I use 3-0 Vicryl. So Vicryl, it falls off on it. And any suture, even we use silk, we don't remove the sutures. It just falls off on its own. I would prefer using a Vicryl so that the irritation that is associated with prolonged silt and over and above fecal contamination of the knots is likely to become irritable. So invariably we'll find it after 3 weeks there are no sutures to be removed. They come out on their own and then patient can take care of it.
Thank you, sir.
Any more questions, anyone? So if there are no more questions, thanks Gautham, thanks for another wonderful lecture. So we'll see you again at 5 p.m. tomorrow. Thank you. Thanks everyone. Dr. Professor Anandi says a very good discussion and she's been trying Zoom for the first time. Ma'am, we are on Zoom all through the day and it'd be very nice if you can come up in some of them if you have time. Thanks for the comment. Thanks everyone. So we shall now we'll be getting out a mechanical ventilation by Bhavin shortly at 6 o'clock and we'll see Gautham again at 5. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you.